Good evening and welcome to today's BIC streams for our program Discovering Jazz by Professor Vern Seelert, scholar, teacher and practitioner of the form, who comes to us today from Moscow, Idaho. This program is in collaboration with the Indian Music Experience Museum. Jazz is a music without borders, born of hybrid strands of the African diaspora and the African-American experience. Jazz has had an international reach as far away as Indian shores in Bombay, Calcutta, and other cities in the early 20th centuries, where African-American musicians arrived, made their mark, and disseminated their music and skills to local musicians. Our elders recount the visit to Bangalore of the legendary Duke Ellington, dashing and elegant, swinging with his orchestra at our iconic Glass House in 1963. And there have been many other jazz luminaries who have performed here, cultural ambassadors who also engaged with local musicians in bringing our musical experiments. The animating force of jazz is improvisation. And for Indian musicians in the Carnatic, Hindustani, and popular traditions, along with its rhythmic complexity, this has been a natural shared connection. So this evening, as we begin the month of April, Jazz Appreciation Month, we celebrate that spirit of invention at the heart of jazz, which serves as a metaphor really for all our endeavors and the illuminating spark for life itself. So before I turn the floor over to Mansi Prasad, director of the Indian Music Experience Museum, I would like to add that jazz remains a conversation and we'd like to keep the conversation going. Professor Seelert will take questions from the audience. Please type your questions in the Q&A box as we go along. Over to you, Mansi, take it away.
Thank you, Pratiti, and welcome to everybody who's watching this. On behalf of the Indian Music Experience Museum and Bangalore International Center, welcome to you all. This evening's talk is part of a new series that is being presented by the IME and the BIC in collaboration. The series is on music genres from around the world. It is planned as a series of quarterly talks, each time featuring a unique musical genre. And this evening, we are very happy to have a talk on Discovering Jazz by an expert musician, Professor Vern Seelert. I'd just like to quickly introduce him before handing it over for the talk. Vern Seelert is professor of trumpet and director of jazz studies at the University of Idaho. He also serves as the artistic advisor for the Lionel Hampton Jazz Festival. From 2001 to 2006, he was director of jazz ensembles at the University of Washington, and he has also served on the faculties of Baylor University, Illinois State University, and Milliken University. Seelert has directed jazz ensembles at high school levels as well. He holds BM degree in jazz studies and music education and a master's in jazz studies from the University of North Texas and a DMA in trumpet performance from the University of Illinois. He's been a student of legendary artists. He's worked with some of the top orchestras. He still maintains a very active performance schedule. He's a composer and arranger as well. So someone with really a wide-ranging expertise in the world of jazz, and we're really happy to have him here. So before I turn it over, just wanted to ask our audience, please do engage with us through the question and answer box, and we'd be happy to facilitate Q&A at the end. Over to you, Vern. Take it away.
Thank you so much, Mansi. It's great to be here with you this evening. As was said, my name is Vern Seelert, and I teach trumpet and run the jazz program at the University of Idaho. And I'm excited to talk to you this evening about jazz. And I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. There we go. Hopefully you can all see that. I have several clips I'd like to share with you, and we're gonna do this in the form of a series of questions, and then hopefully you will have more questions at the end. But we're gonna start off with some music. I hate to stop that right in the middle, but that was the great Wynton Marsalis on trumpet, and a piece that was recorded I believe, back in the fall by his group, or sort of a component of the Lincoln Center Jazz Orchestra. So, like I said, we'll do a series of questions, and of course, the first, we have to define things. That's what we do in academia. We want to know what stuff is. So, the question is, what is jazz? Well, we know that it's a musical art form, and we know that it's performed and enjoyed worldwide. As was said earlier, it really has reached literally around the world, and in every country, there have been performances. There are jazz musicians. It is literally spread all over the world. We also know that jazz encompasses multiple subgenres. I used to say, if you go to the record store — there are not very many record stores anymore — but and you look in the jazz section, you will find a lot of different styles. We'll talk more about maybe some particular ones, but it has morphed and developed quite a bit since its early inception. So there are a lot of different styles of jazz we can talk about and listen to and enjoy. Jazz developed in African American culture, and there are a lot of influences of Western European aspects too, and we'll talk a little bit more in detail about that. And then finally, and this is true in most styles of music for sure, but there is a very high level of communication and interaction among the performers. And we're going to kind of witness a little bit of that here in this next clip. This is also, relatively recently recorded this century, I think about 10 years ago. It's a great saxophonist named Kenny Garrett, along with a drummer named Roy Haynes, who is 91 years old and still going strong, Christian McBride on the bass, and the great Chick Corea, who just passed away a couple months ago. So here's a little bit of, and what I want you to look at is maybe the interaction of the musicians. We'll be right back. like I said before, I hate to stop that in the middle, but you can see and hear a very conversational aspect between, particularly in that case, between the drummer, Roy Haynes, and Kenny Garrett, the alto saxophone player. Now, those of you that have listened to a lot of jazz might hear some of these recordings and videos that I'm playing and really enjoy them. If you're not as familiar with jazz, they might sound a little complicated to you or a little unfamiliar, and that's okay. We can talk about ways to perhaps learn things to help you enjoy the music a little bit more. So we're going to talk about what are the main elements of jazz music. And we'll say, based on that last clip, jazz music generally is highly rhythmic, syncopated, and groove-oriented. What do I mean by that? Well, when we talk about the groove of music, we talk about the rhythmic pulse, the steady pulse of it. And we'll see a little bit later on that one of the main factors in the development of this music was functional. It was a music for dancing. And so that is a big part of one of the main characteristics of jazz is this steady pulse, this groove, this high energy rhythm. Improvisation. So to various levels, improvisation is one of the main components of jazz music. In that last clip, literally everyone was improvising. But improvisation in a jazz setting comes with some guidelines, some rules, some boundaries. So they were improvising over a particular harmonic progression. And much of jazz music, the improvisation in jazz music is cyclical. In other words, there is a harmonic progression, a series of chords, harmonies, that last for a certain amount of time, and that gets repeated, and people improvise over that particular progression. Swing. Now, this one is a little harder to define with words, but I might try to demonstrate here a little bit. The idea that music swings in Western European music, if we say, well, I'm going to play this straight, or I'm going to use straight eighth notes, there's an even amount of space between those notes. They're equal, da 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 da, right? But if we're going to swing that, right, we have changed the distance between those notes. So swing as a concept was very pervasive in early jazz through, you know, the middle part of the 20th century and still today. Now, not all genres of jazz implement this, but most do. So if I'm going to play a line, and so let's see, this might be straight eighth, or if I swing it. So the concept of swing, and also we don't want to confuse swing. There was a time called the swing era that we'll talk about a little bit, where that type of music was very, very popular all over the world. Harmonies. As music developed, Western music, a lot of the harmonies. Very basic, triadic in nature. In other words, mostly three-note chords. And of course, composers would come along and sort of change the approach to harmony. But in jazz, the harmonies tend to be a little bit more colorful overall. Lots of what we call upper extensions of chords. Now, this is not something that jazz musicians necessarily invented. In fact, most of these colorful harmonies were borrowed from some of the late Romantic composers like Ravel and Debussy. But they are very much part of the jazz language today. The sound of the blues, and we'll get into this a little bit more in a minute, over much of recorded jazz, you can hear the sound of, well, let's see, let's we take a major scale, that type of sound, and we apply this type of scale. Right? We are changing certain notes of that scale and lowering them to give that sound. So the sound of the blues is really pervasive in most forms of jazz music. And the final one, deliberate variations of pitch and timbre. Many jazz musicians, I think, want to try to emulate vocalists. And of course, with your voice, you can do many, many things with pitch and with the sound of your voice. And if I was to take a note, and I can vary it any way I want on an instrument, on a wind instrument like a trumpet. And we'll hear some more of that as we go on. All right, let's go and see if you can hear some of these things. Now, this next clip is pretty contemporary, sort of a newer style. And see if you can hear some of those maybe variations in pitch and timbre, particularly in Esperanza Spalding's wonderful bass player, wonderful singer, particularly in her vocals. Again, I hate to stop. And she's an amazing musician, singing and playing bass lines completely independently. It's amazing. Let's talk a little bit about how jazz developed in the United States. And the first is the transatlantic slave trade. Now, from the 16th through the 18th century, literally millions of Africans were captured and put into bondage and brought to various places in the world, Europe, the United States, South America, the Caribbean, and sold as slaves. It was one of the worst examples of man's humanity to man. But that bringing of that culture to the United States caused a combination of lots of cultural elements. And we'll talk a little bit about West African traditions, and one of, you know, obviously, lots of rhythmic things, instrument playing, drums, dancing, but one of kind of the biggest concept to understand is that in African music, the idea of performance is not really the main thing. It is a cultural thing that everyone participates in from the youngest age. That idea, that concept, was brought to this country, and we're talking over generations, like from like earliest, like I said, 1600s through the U.S. Civil War in the 1860s, and after that, and this idea of slavery there are racial injustice issues that we are unfortunately still dealing with today in this country. New Orleans. Now, New Orleans is a city, the southern part of the United States. It's a port city on the Gulf of Mexico. And there was a time where New Orleans was the most cosmopolitan city in the United States, actually even before it was part of the United States. But there was trading and ships coming into port from all over the world. There was the mingling of lots of different cultures, and we talked about, you know, the African culture. There was a big, folks from the West Indies, South America, Europe, Italy, all kinds of sort of conglomeration of different cultures there in New Orleans. And I think there's a quote that says, "Jazz grew up in 1,000 places, but it was born in New Orleans." Because of the mixing of these races, there was a group of people called Creoles and Creoles of color. And these were people of mixed ethnicity, African and many times African and French, or African and Spanish, and which they were lighter skinned. And in sort of the hierarchy, that caste system, this is before the Civil War, had a sort of a higher place, not quite like white people, but a higher place in society. Many Creoles of color were highly educated. They went to Europe to study. New Orleans had several opera houses. It had 3 symphony orchestras. And many of those Creoles of color actually had, they owned slaves as well. So there's this, at least in the arts and in music, there was this high level of classical training with Creoles. Now, after the Civil War in the United States, there was a period called Reconstruction. And the term Jim Crow comes from old minstrel shows. It was actually a character. And it became, after Reconstruction, there were several laws built basically to keep African Americans since slavery was done away with technically, but these laws were passed that were very restrictive, very unjust for African Americans. Now also, as these cultures and these musics mixed over the years, and like I said, it was over generations, the first jazz recordings, actually, ironically, what most scholars consider to be the first jazz recordings were made by a group called the Original Dixieland Jazz Band, which were mostly, was a group of white musicians who recorded in New York. There were offers made to some New Orleans musicians, African-American musicians, but were turned down to record. Now, as this jazz music kind of coalesced and became kind of codified, was right around the time that recording technology developed. So the first jazz recordings, like I said, were made in 1917, so just about 100 years ago. And so, interestingly, we have a recorded history of jazz music and its development, which is pretty cool. But if we say, we want to know what Louis Armstrong sounded like in 1925, we can listen to that, We don't know what Beethoven's music sounded like exactly when it was written, or Mozart's, but we do for sure for jazz music. And like I said earlier, as this music developed, its primary function was for dancing, you know, resulting in the groove orient. And of course, as the years developed, years went by, jazz was elevated to an art form by the great innovators and the great musicians such as Louis Armstrong, later Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie, and the style changed to where it no longer was necessarily a music for dancing, but a music to sit and listen to. And they say that, you know, it's kind of the mid-20th century is when jazz sort of moved from the, you know, the ballroom, you know, into great theaters, you know, like Carnegie Hall. So here's an example of some early jazz. This is the great Louis Armstrong, trumpet player, from 1927, one of his tunes called Hotter Than That. Louis Armstrong, that's actually, I think, the first recorded example of what we call scat singing, vocal improvisation using made-up syllables, not necessarily words. So the roots of jazz, where the musical roots of this music, and pretty much all these styles deal with you know, African-American musical and African-American folk traditions, right? The first work songs and field hollers, whether it was slaves working in the field, picking cotton, singing individually to pass the time, or field hollers where some sort of task was being done, whether it was chopping wood or working on a chain gang or whatever. These are field hollers are songs that were sung collectively. The church. So as you know, the generations went by and these Africans brought into slavery and later freed, we're sort of indoctrinated in the church traditions, particularly of Southern America, Baptist, Methodist, and really became part of that religion. And so in church, we've got, of course, hymns and spirituals, and that you know, the idea of singing in a choir in church became very much part of the tradition. And many, many jazz musicians came up with an upbringing of music in the church. The blues. Remember, I talked about a little bit earlier, the sound of the blues is kind of pervasive in jazz. Blues, as its own genre, developed about the same time from these folk traditions, and we sort of categorize early blues into two types: the more rural, also known as country blues, might be performed by an individual musician, usually male, actually, and self-accompanied, playing for themselves on a stringed instrument of some type, guitar or dobro or banjo or something like that. And blues, you know, the lyrics telling a story of trials and tribulations, of being downtrodden, you know. The other type of blues we'll talk about is more urban blues that developed in the urban areas, in the cities. And those blues actually mostly sung by females and usually accompanied by some sort of group. There are very early recordings of blues singers with, you know, perhaps pipe organ and a trumpet player, but the quality of the lyrics is the same. And the blues eventually developed into a pretty common form. In fact, it's the most common form. The 12-measure blues, 12-bar blues, is the most common form that we see in jazz. And jazz musicians are always, you know, either playing on an actual blues form or using the sound of that blues scale over other harmonies. Ragtime. So ragtime was a piano tradition, very highly syncopated music. That probably the most well-known ragtime composer was a gentleman by the name of Scott Joplin, and like I said, highly syncopated. But one thing about ragtime is it was always written out. There was not a lot of or hardly any improvisation involved in ragtime, unlike these other folk traditions we're talking about. Brass bands. And this is actually, you know, from European tradition, but in the United States, the idea of a brass band or a marching band was very, very popular at the turn of the century, you know, late 1800s, early 1900s. Band leaders like John Philip Sousa wrote marches, and that was a very, very popular form of music. And so those instruments and those roles of the instruments in those marches found their way into early jazz in terms of, let's say, the trumpets in a march mostly had the melody, right? And the trombones had some sort of lower counter melody, whereas the flutes and the clarinets had some sort of high ostinato, sort of more flourishy kind of idea. And those roles were assumed by early New Orleans musicians and improvised on in kind of a collective way. So we're going to watch another clip now. And this one, you might hear a little bit of that that sort of call and response church type sound. This is a great group led by Art Blakey in the 1960s, and this is a tune called Moanin'. And you'll hear a sort of a call and response from everyone. very much blues-oriented sound on that. The great trumpet player, Freddie Hubbard. And I am a trumpet player, so it might seem like I'm playing a lot of trumpet players, but that particular groove on that last tune, we call that a shuffle, and Art Blakey, the drummer, was one of the best shuffle players, one of the best drummers ever, but his, in particular, that shuffle feel that he plays, just tremendous. And his group, Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers, from the 50s all the way through the early 2000s and his death, was kind of a training ground for many, many great jazz musicians. Including actually Wynton Marsalis, who we heard in the first clip. So the most common instruments used in jazz, we've got pictures of them there, but we'll start with the saxophone. Very, very popular in jazz music. Instruments, it's sort of a newcomer, having only been developed by Adolf Sachs in the 1840s. So, and the saxophone comes in a variety of sizes, soprano, alto, tenor, and baritone sax. And there have been tremendous jazz musicians who specialized in each of those. Next, of course, the trumpet. And the lineage of great jazz trumpet players really begins, at least in recorded history, with Louis Armstrong, and goes through Roy Eldridge, Dizzy Gillespie, Clifford Brown, Freddie Hubbard, Lee Morgan, and all the way up to Wynton Marsalis. It's a very, very commanding instrument, and can project very well. The trombone. Our instrument that kind of has remained kind of the same. It hasn't undergone very many technical changes, at least as far as its makeup, since the Renaissance. The piano, guitar, the bass. Now the drum set, and this is an interesting one, going back to talking about brass bands and these groups would march in New Orleans for various functions, weddings, funerals, any kind of celebration, there would usually be a brass band. And for the drums, you would need someone to march with a bass drum, someone else with cymbals, someone maybe else with a snare drum to get all the sounds. Drummers figured out that maybe you can mount a cymbal on top of the bass drum that is strapped here, and you can kind of do that. And as that developed, the drum set really is kind of the only instrument that actually developed because of jazz. All right, it was out of the idea of making it so one person could do the job of three. So they came up with this. What they call the contraption. This contraption is the drum set, and there's a pedal that you can use for the bass drum and a pedal you can use for the hi-hat. Back in the day, they didn't call it a drum set, it was called the trap set. It's short for contraption. And finally, voice. As we heard, Louis Armstrong, great trumpet player, also great vocalist, and because of, the idea of lyrics, voice has been very, very important. So many great jazz vocalists, back from Louis Armstrong to Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, Sarah Vaughan. But here's another concept to think about, though. Jazz can be and has been played by musicians on all types of instruments, and it's hard in a short amount of time to get to all of them. But really, literally, that there are. Jazz oboe recordings and recordings of jazz tuba players and harmonica players. It's all instruments. Here's a little demonstration of that. This is a great violinist named Regina Carter, and you'll get to see a little bit of that, the variety of instruments in this clip. Yeah. that one as well. Just great sounds and a lot of the things that we talked about earlier, the variations in timbre and pitch, the overlaying of that blues scale sound over the music, you could really hear in that clip. So what constitutes a typical jazz group? In the world of jazz, most groups have some kind of rhythm section. We call it a rhythm section. It's the combination of the drums, some sort of keyboard instrument, in other words, an instrument that can play chords, such as piano, guitar, sometimes both of those will be in a rhythm section, a vibraphone, anything that can play chords, multiple notes, and then a bass player of some sort. In the early days, it might be a tuba would be fulfilling that function. Later on, upright bass borrowed from the orchestra, and electric bass as well. And the roles of those instruments, they each have sort of a shared role. The bass player and the drummer will be responsible for the pulse, right? The quarter note pulse, ding 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 ding, all constantly in a jazz piece. The bass player and the piano player will be responsible for the harmonic form. In other words, what chords happen when, and the bass player will take care of playing the roots of those chords. And then the drummer and the pianist or the chordal instrument have another role that we call comping. And that's kind of short for accompaniment. Some people say it's short for complementing. But that's the sort of the rhythmic interjections in between ideas that a soloist might play. So rhythm section, very, very important in jazz music. Most of recorded jazz is done by smaller groups, usually 3 to 6 musicians. But that obviously can vary, sometimes with a vocalist, sometimes not, just depending on the group. And then another big part of jazz music is the larger group known as the big band. And that sort of size group sort of developed really starting in the late 1920s and became very popular in the 1930s, all the way up until kind of the end of World War II. It was what we call sort of the swing era. And big bands such as Duke Ellington, Count Basie, Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller were very, very popular all over the world. And that also brings in the idea of when you have that many musicians, you can't have everybody improvising all the time. So the idea of the arranger or the composer arranger having to notate things for everyone to play comes into focus, and there have been many, many, many great jazz arrangers for that genre of music. There's a picture right here of a wonderful contemporary arranger, and her name is Maria Schneider, and she's one of my favorite arrangers for that larger jazz orchestra sound. We're going to see an example of this. This is the great Duke Ellington and a wonderful singer Ella Fitzgerald. We heard Louis Armstrong scat sing a little while ago. We're going to hear some of Ella doing that on one of Duke Ellington's most popular tunes. Had to play that one all the way through. That's so great. What are the major styles? What are the major sort of genres in jazz? As I said before, there are many, many, subgenres and different styles in this music. And what I've got here is just kind of a list and when they sort of came into being. Now, the interesting thing about all these different styles is that they've continued. Like traditional jazz, the music of Louis Armstrong, New Orleans-style jazz, Chicago-style jazz, there are places in the world that is still very popular, musicians that specialize in that type of music. We talked about the swing era. As this music got more and more popular and the groups got bigger, that was probably the only time that jazz or jazz-related music was the most popular music in the United States. I'm having trouble with my mouse here. There we go. Bebop. Now, this is a style that came along in the mid-1940s with musicians experimenting with the idea of improvisation and making the harmonies a little bit more complex, maybe making the tempos a little faster. In fact, a lot of bebop was played at a very fast tempo, which made it not so good for dancing. and the melodies got a little bit more complex, but sort of the you know, the fathers of bebop would be, you know, Charlie Parker, the saxophonist, and Dizzy Gillespie, the trumpet player. Hard bop is a style that sort of grew out of bebop. That the example of Art Blakey would be a perfect example of that. Some of it much more shuffle oriented as far as the grooves, more like backbeats, in other words, like the snare drum hitting on 2 and 4, kind of elements of hard bop. And like I said, all of these styles are still with us today. And of course, all these styles tend to mix together as well. We have the cool jazz in the early 1950s, sort of a little more reserved approach. Miles Davis, a collection of recordings that he made, actually, I think 1949, that were put together called Birth of the Cool. And a lot of musicians on the West Coast were sort of kind of in that sort of that cool school of playing. Modal jazz. So this is the idea also kind of pioneered by Miles Davis. Miles Davis was a big, he helped the music go in a lot of different directions during his, you know, gosh, 50 plus year career as a jazz musician. Modal jazz is the idea of rather than playing on a particular chord progression, like as in a popular song, or a song like that, Duke Ellington, It Don't Mean a Thing, jazz musicians experimented with staying on one chord or one sound for a long time. A great example of that music is the Miles Davis record called Kind of Blue, which was recorded in 1959. The idea of free jazz, sometimes called avant-garde, spearheaded by another saxophonist named Ornette Coleman, the idea that you could improvise collectively without a preset set of chord changes or a preset idea as far as form or length of a song. In the early 1960s, we saw experiments, something called third stream, that the idea of jazz and classical music mixing together, in sometimes in terms of like form of the pieces, or particularly like in instrumentation, using more strings. A composer named Gunther Schuller, who was also a very important jazz historian, was big in that third stream movement. Latin jazz, the idea of combining jazz and improvisation and that sound with music from the Latin American community, South America, and it became very popular in the early 1960s with the bossa nova craze, recordings by Antonio Carlos Jobim and a saxophonist named Stan Getz. And the last one we'll talk about is we call fusion, and I know fusion is kind of a generic term, putting anything together, but in the jazz world, when we talk about fusion, it's the combination of jazz styles and rock and roll styles. Miles Davis, once again, had a hand in that. In the late 1960s, a record of his called In a Silent Way, and then followed that by one called Bitches Brew, where it used electric, you know, instruments more associated with rock and roll, electric guitar, electric bass, electric keyboards. This picture over here is actually a great guitarist named Pat Metheny. And the one over here on the left is actually, that's that group, the original Dixieland jazz band that was credited with making the first jazz recordings. And here's another sort of a contemporary group that kind of shows some of that fusion and sort of funk and rhythm and blues sound. This is a group called Snarky Puppy. Okay. are some of the great innovators in jazz? And there have been many. These are people, and this is, it's hard to make a list like this because inevitably I'll leave someone off that people think, why didn't you have that person on this list? But we'll just kind of go down the line here. Louis Armstrong really brought jazz from a soloist art. In early forms of New Orleans jazz, there had been a lot of collective improvisation. In other words, where like trumpet and clarinet and trombone had been improvising at the same time, and he really made it a soloist art. Jelly Roll Morton, who was also an early New Orleans musician, kind of credited with kind of being the first to arrange music and write music down, jazz music, the way he wanted to hear it. So an important early jazz composer and pianist. Of course, Duke Ellington, sort of the father of the big band of orchestrating for that instrumentation, arguably the most important composer of any kind to come out of the United States, certainly our most prolific composer, wrote over 2,000 pieces of music. Charlie Parker, we mentioned as a sort of a innovator in the bebop style. Dizzy Gillespie, a contemporary of Charlie Parker's, they recorded a lot together in the late 1940s, early 1950s. The great composer and pianist Thelonious Monk, also considered to be one of our greatest jazz composers, but in opposition to Duke Ellington, Thelonious only wrote about 75 pieces of music, but they're all great and still played today and learned by jazz musicians. Ella Fitzgerald, who we saw a little while ago, one of the most amazing vocal improvisers there is. Miles Davis, we talked about, who really helped change the direction of jazz music multiple times, whether it was playing bebop with Charlie Parker, that's where he got his start, pioneering cool jazz, modal jazz, fusion in the late 1960s. Billie Holiday, another wonderful vocalist, kind of opposite end of the spectrum from Ella Fitzgerald. She rarely, if ever, did any scat singing, but her greatness came in how she could deliver a lyric and paraphrase a melody of a song. John Coltrane, the really great voice on the tenor saxophone, pioneered modal jazz with Miles Davis in the late 1950s, went on to pursue that, and then to pursue a little bit more of the avant-garde style as well with his later recordings in the 1960s. Herbie Hancock, who is still around today, also got his start in the 1960s playing with Miles Davis, pioneering different keyboard instruments, also a great composer. And then Wayne Shorter, also of that generation, played with Miles Davis, was in the fusion movement with a band called Weather Report, also great composers, great composer. So a few final thoughts. I know I've been talking a lot, and hopefully there'll be some questions out there, but jazz has played all over the world, and through improvisation and shared knowledge of standard repertoire, in other words, knowing sort of the same tunes, jazz musicians, can, they don't always, but can perform on little to no rehearsal. If I was to, I live out here in rural Moscow, Idaho, but if I was to go to any big city anywhere, I could go to London tomorrow and I could meet, a rhythm section and we could decide, hey, we're going to play, let's play this tune, and we all would know it and we all understand kind of the rules of how the music works. Jazz is learned through listening to and studying jazz masters, much like learning a language. Sort of the three steps in learning to play jazz music, this is an idea of the great Clark Terry, a great trumpet player. Imitation, your first step is imitating what you hear. Assimilation, taking that information and figuring out what it is. What are the notes over this chord? How does this work? And finally, innovation. And the goal in jazz music is really to develop your own voice on whatever instrument that you play. Jazz music has always contained a balance between the sort of the earthy, soulful, emotional content and the more intellectual aspects, as far as intricacies in harmony and rhythm. It's a music of expressiveness, of joy, and of perseverance. And finally, jazz has always had an open arms policy. It is combined easily with many, many other forms of music from all over the world, and will likely continue to do so. So with that, we'll see if there are any questions. And this picture, you might, I'll turn off my share screen, but I have that same picture. People were asking about it earlier. It's a photo called The Great Day in Harlem, and it was taken in 1958 by a photographer for Esquire magazine who was doing a story on jazz. And in this particular picture, there are some of the greatest jazz musicians in New York at the time. There's one over on the right here, there's Dizzy Gillespie sticking his tongue out, making a joke, and then it's Roy Eldridge who happened to turn around but just at the wrong time when that picture was taken. So I'll stop sharing my screen right now and just turn it back to Manasi and see if there's any questions that anybody has.
Thank you, Vern. You know, as you were talking through the last slide on the screen, what struck me so much was, if you take out the word jazz and you replace it with Indian classical music, every single one of those things would actually be true. The fact that it's based on a certain shared standard repertoire, which means that I can go to another city and there'll be somebody in the audience who says, I'm actually playing with you on the mridangam today. I'll be like, oh, nice to meet you. What's your name? And we can actually do a whole concert together with a minimal sort of rehearsed music because of this shared repertoire that we have. We also learn at the feet of great masters because of the Guru Shishya tradition, where music is passed from the teacher to the student and so on to future generations. It is also a balance between the mind and the heart. There's mathematics, there's science, there's grammar, there's rules, but there's also emotion, there's creativity, there's all that. And just like jazz, I think Indian music has the capacity to be so open and welcoming of genres from anywhere, which is why I think there has been so much interaction between Indian music and jazz, especially over the past few decades. You know, people like Miles Davis were heavily influenced by Indian music. You had artists like Ravi Shankar who worked with many jazz legends and so on and so on. So the connections, of course, bring your wonderful presentation home so much more because it makes us relate to it. And I must compliment you on the sheer extent of the world of jazz that you were able to bring to us in just the span of an hour, and makes us all curious and excited to learn more. So thank you for that. And with that, we'll sort of move on to some of the questions. I would say, because we have quite a few of them, I would have to request you to keep your answers brief so that we can get through as many of them as possible.
Okay.
Sure. And some of them you would have already touched upon. Abraham starts off by asking, of course, about the roots of jazz in African traditions, which you did speak about, the folk influences from West Africa, etc. But he sort of adds a comment there that, you know, African music being more rooted in percussion, which again is probably a statement open to interpretation, not string and wind. So I just wanted to ask you specifically about African drumming and its influences on jazz. Do you see sort of direct connections there, and continue to today?
I think so, and I'm not being an expert on African music, but I know that like jazz, and like you were saying with Indian classical music, there are cyclical patterns in the performance. In other words, in the form of the music. So that for sure, I think is a part of it. And one of the things I didn't mention, but as you know, slaves were brought to this country and basically, you know, over generations kind of stripped of their own heritage. One of the things in New Orleans, there was a place called Congo Square, and it was a place where for several decades musicians were allowed to play their own instruments, their drums, and not necessarily ones they weren't allowed to bring anything from Africa, but ones that they had fashioned out of whatever they could. But that is a way that some of the drumming tradition kind of, I think, kept going and maybe found its way into early jazz music. Because remember, we're talking a span of, you know, early 1600s, really, till, I mean, there's a long time for those elements to combine and coalesce.
Sure. Yes, of course. So the influences are there in different ways. And, you know, one only has to hear New Orleans drummers to, you know, to understand this. You know, it's hard to understand, but there's so much complexity that's involved, and it's quite amazing. So we spoke about jazz and blues and the blues scale. So Sybil is asking about, of course, the differences between jazz and blues, how would you sort of define this? Would you say the blues are a kind of jazz, or, you know, how exactly would you characterize this relationship as a parent-child, as a subgenre, as an influencer? What would be your way of defining
that? That's a great question. And I think so the blues has sort of evolved and developed into its own genre, for sure. Musicians like B.B. King and Keb Mo, and there is a whole world of that where most everything is based on blues type progressions. Whereas in jazz, like I said, we use that blues progression a lot. I mean, there are, you know, literally probably thousands of jazz melodies that are based on a 12-measure blues. That element of early blues is definitely a huge influence on jazz. And you know, some people, depending on how they define what jazz is, I know that Wynton Marsalis says if it doesn't contain some sort of element of the blues, it's not jazz, right? He's said that at least at one time. But I think you the blues probably more as a parent, I think, but with lots of influence, and then jazz grew up to be this its own different personality.
But rebellious still, teenager, if you were. All right. So there are so many different types of music that call themselves jazz. And you touched upon some of sort of the main elements that one looks for to listen and identify, is this really jazz or is it something else? So Simon is asking, if you were to sort of boil it down to one word, would you say improvisation is one thing that defines jazz, or what would be, if you could boil it down to like one or two words?
That's a great question. It's tough. The idea of improvisation, I mean, that is not, you know, confined to jazz, in Indian classical music, like you were saying. But we hear improvisation in the blues. We hear it in rock and roll. We heard it in early Western classical music. You know, at the end of a concerto, someone was expected to improvise their cadenza. You know, I'm thinking of other roots music in the United States, bluegrass. There's just lots of improvisation. So I don't know if it'd be that. If I had to put one word to it, I would probably say swing.
Swing.
Right.
Yeah. That's sort of an intangible almost concept. I tried to define it with sort of the way, you know, notes are played, but there's so much more to it than that.
Absolutely. Right. I mean, with something like jazz, it's with any genre of music, it's hard to sort of reduce it to a few words, because like anything, it's evolved over centuries and has a life of its own. I'm going to next, and I want to apologize in advance to everybody who's tuned in. We have a very enthusiastic audience who've asked lots of questions. We will definitely not be able to get through all of them, especially because I want to have 2 minutes in the end where we can hear you play a little more, if that's okay. So I'll get through quickly a few more of them, and I want to hear you play. So we'll get to one from Nimi, and I want to paraphrase it a little bit with a little bit of a difficult question that I want to ask you. You know, we've spoken about the whole difficult relationship of, you know, African-American culture with the mainstream. And, you know, were they hindered in any way from practicing their music, which you said, of course, there were impediments and barriers to it. I wanted to sort of connect that to this whole idea of cultural appropriation. Mm-hmm. And jazz today is, of course, a universal shared experience, but how do musicians, especially maybe the non-African-American ones, address this question of cultural appropriation?
That's a great question and a difficult question. And we've seen that appropriation in jazz for sure. Like I said, the earliest jazz recordings were made by white musicians in New York. And there's different schools of thought about those recordings. On the one hand, and we didn't listen to any of them today, but if you listen to that, I'm trying to think of the two. Livery Stable Blues is one, and Original Dixie Jazz Band One Step is the other side. Those tunes almost sound like caricatures of what New Orleans music sounded like. They're a little bit more bombastic, and so many people discount that as like that's not the real thing. On the other hand, early jazz musicians, Louis Armstrong speaks very highly of that group and said that he was influenced by those sounds. Other sort of early jazz musicians, Frankie Trumbauer, they listened to that and it had an influence. So definitely the appropriation thing has been around, and we see it in rock and roll music as well. But I think nowadays it just a respect for the great masters and the people who really developed this music were African Americans, and just realizing that and acknowledging that, I think is the with jazz musicians. I mean, there's a camaraderie and a brotherhood that transcends race, I think. Another example of that, one of the pictures, and I forgot to mention it, I had a picture of Benny Goodman quartet, and of course Benny Goodman was a great clarinet player, but he was one of the, he had the first racially integrated jazz group in the 1930s. It was the Benny Goodman Quartet, and the vibraphone player in that group was Lionel Hampton, and my university where I teach, our music school, is named after Lionel Hampton. We're the only music school that I know of, in the United States, that's named after a jazz musician and named after an African American.
That's amazing. Thank you for that answer to quite a complex question. I wanted to make, before moving on to the next question, I just wanted to do a quick shout out. We have quite a few important people permanent fixtures of Bangalore's culture community here. We have Vijay Padaki, who has founded the Bangalore Little Theatre. We have Anmol Velani, again, a very popular and important arts person from the India Foundation for the Arts. Vijay Padaki, of course, talks about fondly remembering the Ellington concerts in the 1960s. And Anmol had a quick question as to, which genre would you place a pianist like Cecil Taylor?
I think Cecil Taylor definitely, I think, in the free avant-garde category, tremendous facility on the piano, just amazing. There's a live, I'm going to blank on the name of the piece, but it's really exciting, electric, and it's I think almost completely free yet very complex, where he's playing, you know, one thing in the right hand and another thing in the left hand, and he's very, very muscular at the piano. I think he was known for breaking piano strings a lot, but with the intensity that he played with. But I on the other hand, there are early Cecil Taylor recordings that are much more, in the jazz world, we would say much more straight ahead, which is kind of, if there's something straight ahead, it's more like swinging kind of. Project with John Coltrane and Cecil Taylor that's much more inside, as we would say, as opposed to free music, which sometimes we say is outside.
I wanted to pick off from Nimi's question and leading into Mayank's question. They're both sort of asking, so, you know, by the final years of sort of the slave trade, was jazz recognized as sort of a coherent genre? So when did it sort of coalesce into this genre? And secondly, did any of these early musicians actually call themselves jazz musicians?
Well, to answer your last question, no, I don't think so. That brings up another interesting topic, is the origins of the word jazz, right? And many jazz musicians Miles Davis hated that word. He said jazz was a white man's word, is what he said. Duke Ellington liked to call it African-American folk music. So no, they didn't use the word jazz, we have pretty early examples of recordings, right? But we don't have all the way back, you know. We talk about Louis Armstrong as being the earliest, but there were definitely stories of earlier New Orleans musicians that unfortunately we don't have recordings of. Probably back in like the 1890s or so, that music was probably starting to sound what we think of as early jazz, if that makes
sure.
sense.
Perfect. Makes sense. We have Tim Hoffman, who is actually, he plays a variety of Japanese instruments, and he's actually trained in Indian music. We've had him at the IME before, and he touches on this concept of modality. So there's sort of, when we talk about musical modes in the context of music of the East, if I may, you're referring to sort of the world of ragas, of course, but, you know, sort of music which is based on a scale and a certain combination of notes and the interrelationships between them. And then you have tonality, which is sort of, something slightly different, but you did speak about modal jazz. And so, of course, there would be connections to Indian music there. Would you agree with that?
Yes, definitely.
That's great.
In terms of jazz, when we talk about modes, most of it comes from just modes of the major scale, the Western European major scale, and a lot of I think of the Miles Davis tune called "So What," which is just based on the Dorian scale, this kind of sound, and in one sense it has a form. It's 32 measures long. But we call it an AABA tune. The A sections are all D minor, like D Dorian. The B section for 8 measures goes up a half step, so it's E flat Dorian, and then one more A section. So it's some people think, well, that's an easy tune to play on because it's just 2 chords. I actually think it's a very difficult tune to play on because it's just 2 chords. Modality in Eastern forms of music, obviously completely different scale sounds, but the idea of creating a melody not necessarily based on particular chord tones, but the sound of the overall scale.
Yes, absolutely. I think that's a common sort of idea between the two. I'd like to sort of take this as the last question, which I think will sort of help people dig deeper because there seems to be more interest. So could you suggest some good books or where do people go to sort of learn more about jazz?
That's a great question.
We can't come to Lionel Hampton School of Jazz. We'd love to all come there and learn from you. But failing that, some books.
Well, let's see. Books. One that I really like, and it's a few years old, but there's a great documentary series by Ken Burns, just entitled Jazz. And it's, I think, 12 episodes with great footage, really great in-depth historical perspective on the music. I if someone really wants to learn about sort of the history of the music, that's a really good place to start. I think what I would say is if there was anything that out there that you hear that you like, try to explore that person's music more, and if it's jazz, great. If it's not, that's great too. If you enjoy it and it speaks to you and it has some meaning for you, then that's the important thing. I'm a big fan. There's a lot of great jazz biographies, written autobiographies and things. There are several on Duke Ellington that are wonderful. A really great one by Lawrence Berggren on Louis Armstrong that I think really paints a really great image of what New Orleans was like in the early 20th century when Louis Armstrong was coming up. Everything's available at your fingertips on the internet. It's very overwhelming, that everything's out there.
Absolutely. I think, so just to sort of round up and lead into your piece, which we'd love to hear you play just a little bit for a few minutes. I just wanted to say the wonderful thing about presentations like this is, just like you said, there's so much information on the internet. There's so much music out there, but to have someone interpret it for you, and that's what I keep speaking about as the core purpose of our museum as well. It's to inform, it's to interpret, and it's to inspire. And I think you've done all three very successfully today. So please end with a little bit of your wonderful music.
Oh, okay. Let's see. Well, you don't usually hear a trumpet just by itself, but I'm going to try to, I'll play a couple choruses of a blues.
Amazing. That was so wonderful. And for those of you who are listening, I'm sure you can find more of Vern's music online. So before I sign off and hand back over to Pratiti, I again wanted to say thank you to Vern for this amazing beginning to our series of talks. I wanted to ask all our audience to please follow the Indian Music Experience's various activities. You can find us online at indianmusicexperience.org, or you can follow us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, etc. We have a whole variety of different kinds of programming we do. And yes, do visit the museum. It's the only one of its kind in the country. Our next talk in this series is going to be on the 2nd of July. So this talk is planned for the first Friday of every quarter. And next quarter, the talk is going to be by Bob Santelli, the founding executive director of the Grammy Museum. And he's going to be speaking about reggae, this amazing form of music, Caribbean form of music. And I hope all of you will tune in for that. And with that, I'll hand over back to Pratiti. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Manasi, and thank you, Professor Steelert, for that rich journey today across the Atlantic to the African diaspora in the southern United States and beyond. A kind of whistle-stop tour of the history, styles, and major figures of jazz. Really, you've brought to life with wonderful examples its spirit of invention, which is where we began. Thanks to our audience for tuning in and for your questions and participation. Please join us for our next program on BIC Streams.